Hello and welcome to Dental Studies Simplified. I'm Dr. Ankita Kotecha and today we will discuss the next objective of our chapter, Periodontal Plastic and Aesthetic Surgery. The second objective, problems with aberrant frenum. In this chapter, we have five objectives. Problems with attached gingiva, which we have discussed till now, up till last videos, that is problems with attached gingiva and its treatment options, except for enamel matrix proteins, which I have kept aside for discussion with tissue engineering, which is the last objective of this chapter. So after discussing problems with attached gingiva, today we will discuss problems with aberrant frenum, and then we will discuss problems with shallow vestibule, aesthetics and tissue engineering. This is how we are going to complete this entire chapter, periodontal plastic and aesthetic surgery. So for today's video, the topic is problems with aberrant frenum and its treatment options, which are frenectomy and frenotomy. So a frenum is nothing but a fold of mucous membrane with underlying muscular attachments. What it attaches? Lips and cheeks to the alveolar mucosa. Primarily, it has to attach the lips and cheeks to the alveolar mucosa, but sometimes it attaches to the gingiva and of course the underlying periosteum. So based on this definition, we will discuss the categorization of maxillary labial frenum given by Plesac et al. Remember, Plesac et al. 1974, he categorized frenal attachment based on his observations related to maxillary labial frenum. Clear? So this is the mucogingival junction, keratinized gingiva, that is attached gingiva, marginal gingiva and papilla. So how he categorized is, if the attachment of the frenum is within mucogingival junction or at max at mucogingival junction, it's a mucosal attachment. If the attachment of the frenum is in attached gingiva, it's a gingival. If the attachment is into the papilla, it's papillary. And if the attachment is into the papilla but crossing over onto its palatal aspect, that is papillary penetrating. So this is how the categorization of frenum is done as per Plesac et al. 1974. So based on this, we understand frenum is a fold of mucous membrane attaching the lips and cheeks to the underlying alveolar mucosa. So if it is mucosa, no problem. Even if it is attached gingiva, as per the definition, alveolar mucosa or gingiva and underlying periosteum, till attached gingiva, no problem. The problem arises if the attachment is papillary or papillary penetrating. That is, if the frenum is attached to the papilla or papilla penetrating, because then this frenum will cause tension or pull onto the marginal gingiva. And once the frenum causes the tension or pull onto the marginal gingiva, it will result into pocketing, which is in the case with thicker biotypes, and recession if it is a thinner biotype. However, in either cases, be it pocketing or recession, it will impair the oral hygiene performance. That is, our routine oral hygiene performance will be impaired. How? Because this frenum will impair the appropriate toothbrush placement. If you have seen my video on guidelines for proper toothbrushing, I have emphasized again and again that toothbrush placement is one of the most important aspects as well, along with other aspects of course, but toothbrush placement matters a lot. So this frenal attachment will impair the appropriate toothbrush placement, thereby impairing our oral hygiene in daily routine. And then this will lead to biofilm accumulation, altogether impairing the entire oral hygiene. That is why this frenum is problematic. I told you when we discussed the introduction of this chapter, I told you frenum is harmless. Don't trouble the trouble until the trouble troubles you. So here, as we can appreciate, if it is well within its limits, that is mucosa or attached gingiva. Mark the words, attached gingiva. But if it is encroaching onto the papilla, thereby causing tension or pull onto the marginal gingiva and the papilla, then it is a problem. So then, because the trouble is now troubling us, we have to trouble it. So how we will trouble it? How we will treat it? By the two surgical procedure options, that is phrenectomy and phrenotomy. So now, what is phrenectomy? What is phrenotomy? The alternative names are, because frenum is alternatively called as frenulum, phrenectomy is also called as frenulectomy, and phrenotomy is alternatively called as frenulotomy, ectomy, otomy. So basically, the difference is ectomy means complete excision, complete removal. Otomy means partial removal or relocation or repositioning of the frenum. So phrenectomy, in henceforth we will use these two names, but I have already mentioned the two alternative names. So if the question or the terminology in the textbook says frenulectomy or frenulotomy, please don't get confused, they are same. It's just because frenum is also called as frenulum, that is why phrenectomy is frenulectomy, phrenotomy is frenulotomy. Okay, so I hope the terminologies are clear here. There's no confusion between the terminologies. With this phrenectomy, as I've already discussed, it's complete removal along with its underlying attachments to the bone as well. See how radical the approach is. And as a periodontist, we should not be radical. This is the difference between our specialty, the specialty periodontics, and other specialties of dentistry. As a periodontist, our approach should be more conservative. So with the definition itself, phrenectomy is a radical approach, complete excision or removal of the frenum along with its underlying attachments. And phrenotomy is partial excision or partial removal, or more appropriately, relocating or repositioning of the frenum. There is no complete removal or even nothing to do with removal of its underlying attachments. So phrenotomy sounds a conservative approach, and that is why it is usually told that phrenotomy is sufficient enough to serve the purpose in any case, except, obviously there are exceptions everywhere, so here are also some exceptions. So with this we will understand when to do phrenectomy, when to do phrenotomy. See, phrenectomy is performed when the frenum is the whole and sole cause or the reason behind the disease or the clinical feature. So for example, the most common feature observed is a midline diastema, which is to be corrected by orthodontic approach. So here, usually if it's papillary penetrating or it's papillary also, of course we have options of phrenotomy and phrenectomy. But because the reason for the diastema is this frenum, it is usually advisable to perform phrenectomy. Remember, our treatment plan is rectifying the etiology. So if we understand by the case diagnosis and clinical examination that the frenum is responsible for that midline diastema, then why to keep a scope of recurrence by performing phrenotomy? That is, phrenotomy is relocation of the frenum. So why to keep that frenum into the oral cavity? Let's just excise it in total and prevent the scope of recurrence or any future chances of rebounds. So in such cases where we understand that frenum is completely responsible for that diastema or for that matter any recession, then we have to perform phrenectomy. This is a general guideline. And if there are certain cases which are not possible to be performed because a frenum is present there, let's say for example vestibule deepening procedure or a free gingival grafting procedure where the frenum is hindering the positioning of the graft, or the shallow vestibule cannot be treated because a frenum is present there, in such cases phrenotomy works well. So understood the difference between the indication criteria for both phrenectomy and phrenotomy? If the frenum is the etiology, phrenectomy. appendectomy. And if the frenum is hindering the performance of other surgical procedures such as vestibuloplasty, that is sulcus deepening procedure, or free gingival grafting, or for that matter any root coverage procedure where pedicle flap is prepared or advanced flap is prepared, then frenotomy works. But overall, we should be more conservative in our approach, because in today's era where we are coming up with so many minimally invasive surgical techniques, we should always try to perform frenotomy. And if a frenotomy is performed thoroughly, it works for every case. But we should again judge the case as per the case diagnosis and the findings. Every case is different, and as I said, this principle cannot be applied to every case. So we have to have a thorough diagnosis of the case. So now that we understand when to perform frenectomy and frenotomy, now we will discuss each of the treatment option in detail. First we will discuss frenectomy, and then we will discuss frenotomy, so that we understand what are the differences in their surgical steps. So for frenectomy, this is our lip and here is the attachment. This is the apex of the attachment. Okay. So if this is the fold that we are referring to, this frenal fold, let's say maxillary labial frenum, this is the lateral aspect I'm trying to show. If this is the fold of the mucous membrane, imagine this triangular piece with the apex in the papilla, and these are the underlying muscular attachments. Frenectomy is performed as follows. First step is adequate anesthesia, followed by engaging this frenum with a hemostat. Hemostat this way. So once this hemostat is placed appropriately, well enough into, like it is able to engage the entire frenum, then once this hemostat is placed here, then the first incision is above the hemostat, that is between the lips and the hemostat. The second incision is below the hemostat, that is between the gingiva and the hemostat. The incision should extend well enough beyond this hemostat. So, on to this picture, the first incision is above the hemostat, and the second incision is, it should go beyond the tip. This is the level of the tip, so this incision should go beyond the tip, and the second incision, from below the hemostat, it should go beyond and meet this incision, thereby excising this triangular piece of the frenum. This is how the frenum are eliminated. Okay, but this will be a triangular mucus fold. It is obviously a fold of mucous membrane, so don't expect it to be some large and thick or fleshy tissue. It will be a mucous membrane, so it will be a thin membrane. Clear? Which will be engaged in this hemostat by our excision. So again, I'll just redraw. This is our hemostat. First incision above the hemostat, second incision below. Obviously, it will start from the apex, but for completing the triangle piece that will be eliminated, I'm drawing it from here. So again, no confusion. This is our hemostat. The first incision begins here and the second incision here, and this is how both the incisions are connected, and this triangular piece which will be engaged into the hemostat is eliminated. So once this triangular piece is eliminated, what happens is a rhomboid or a diamond shape opening will be created. This is the labial aspect. Okay, so this is the lip aspect, and this is the attached gingiva. This is the base of the vestibule. So before learning the further steps, let us understand the anatomy here. This is the labial mucosa. So these margins are pertaining to the labial mucosa. This is the base of the vestibule. And then begins these attached gingiva. This is all the gingival portion. Okay, so if we divide this rhomboid or diamond into imaginary two triangles, just for our simplification, we don't have to do anything. Once these two incisions are completed and this diamond shape opening is opened, the upper triangle referring to the labial mucosa aspect and the lower triangle, for our understanding, it is a rhomboid totally, there is no partition. We have created a partition for our understanding. The upper triangle refers to the labial mucosa aspect, the lower triangle refers to the gingiva aspect. Now we have to work onto this lower triangle. What we see here is the muscular attachments. So what we have to do is we have to eliminate all the muscular attachments, we have to score the underlying periosteum, we have to do blunt dissection. Clear? Because the definition of phrenectomy is complete removal of the frenum along with its attachment to the underlying bone. So except for the bone, almost everything can be eliminated, of course, right? So that is what is performed here. Now, when this step is completed, that is all the attachments, periosteum can be kept intact, okay? So when all the attachments are eliminated totally, please stick to the definition. So when all the attachments are eliminated so that there is no further scope of reformation of the frenum, that's how the radical approach is. Now the time is to suture. Now here we have two options. One is if the two margins, now when the lower triangle is sorted, now go to the upper triangle. When these two margins can be approximated, then we have to perform suturing. This is one option, one way of suturing. First is suture at this base point. First, approximate this widest portion, the base of the vestibule. Suture it here first, and then the remaining aspect can be sutured. If you find that the folds are not approximating by itself, give one more suture for the approximation. And as far as this lower half is remain, it may heal by secondary intention, or alternatively what we can do is the second option, just give horizontal incision in this base of the vestibule and extend it. What we can do is suture this labial mucosa margins to the periosteum of the gingiva and then place connective tissue graft here for better aesthetic aspects, from aesthetic point of view, and healing as well. Okay, so again I will repeat, the first way to suture is without giving any horizontal extensions. If these labial mucosa margins can approximate by itself, suture it starting from the base point. Okay, these base point are approximated first, and then the remaining portion, like when the base point is approximated, it will usually look like this. Here there will be the first approximation, but this two margins, if it is long, then may look separate. So again, to join them, another set of suture can be performed, and the remaining lower half can be kept open, which may heal by secondary intention. Alternatively, what we can do when this triangle, sorry, this rhomboid is formed, what we can do, we can just give horizontal extensions. So it will become like this. And what we can do, we can suture these labial mucosa to the apical periosteum. And then here we can place graft. Okay, so in whichever style, whichever manner we complete the suture, generally the suturing is performed in a manner such that this labial mucosa related triangle is sutured for complete closure, primary healing, and the lower triangle which is related to gingiva is either kept open for secondary healing or covered by a graft. Clear? This is how phrenectomy is performed. Please keep in mind two incisions, one above the hemostat, one below the hemostat. In chronology, first it has to be above the hemostat, then it has to be below the hemostat, and the triangular piece of the mucous membrane, the most important and the differentiating aspect between phrenectomy and phrenotomy. In phrenotomy, you won't find this triangular piece. So please, I'm repeating this procedure so that we are ready to learn the next treatment option. this mucous membrane triangular piece is not going to be, you will not find it in phrenotomy. So this is the most important and the differentiating aspect. Then this rhomboid shape opening is created, wherein all the attachments are eliminated, and then suturing the labial mucosa aspect and keeping the lower triangle aspect open for secondary intention healing or grafting. So this is how phrenectomy is performed, and the final result will be no frenum at all. There will be new attached gingiva here, and the frenum is eliminated completely. This is how the final result will look like. At least 1 month is required for complete healing and the frenum. Okay, this is phrenectomy. Now we will discuss phrenotomy. Phrenotomy is a simple procedure, relatively nothing complicated or radical to do. What we do in phrenotomy is what we do here is, let's say the attachment is here, we give one incision, one on both the sides, so that the frenum is just opened up. It is like, imagine onto this duster please, if this is the papilla attachment here, this pin is papillary attachment. What is done is one incision is given and the frenum is opened. That's it. This is how the incision is given. Let us imagine giving incision here and the frenum opens, and when it opens, there is a wound created, a tiny, okay, this is how a wound is opened. This wound can be sutured. Nothing much to do in phrenotomy, because phrenotomy is the not complete removal of the frenum, it is just partial removal. So once this incision is given and the wound creation is done, what is done is the tissue tags are eliminated. Any improper tissue attachments or the margins are eliminated, and then the periosteum is scored. Okay, the periosteum, please remember, we are keeping everything intact, even the periosteum, because we are performing phrenotomy. So in contrast to phrenectomy, where we engaged with hemostat and gave two incisions, one above and one below, here we are doing phrenotomy with only single incision with a 15 number scalpel blade in both the cases. So here as well, 15 number scalpel blade, no hemostat used to engage, because I told you, you will not find any triangular piece of mucous membrane. Just one single incision to just remove the frenum from its original attachment point, the height or the position of the attachment of the frenum, because we are not targeting to remove the frenum. We are performing phrenotomy, means we are going to relocate the frenum. So we will not excise the frenum. So from its attachment, we are just detaching the frenum from its original attachment position, and we will shift it to a more apical position. So when this incision is given up till where we want to relocate it, the incision should extend up till there, then this opening will be created. This aspect is the labial mucosa aspect, and this is the, as usual, the wound creation, two triangles. Just imagine two triangles, the upper triangle related to the labial mucosa aspect and the lower triangle related to the gingival aspect. Here, after the wound creation, one tiny suture, because we have not given too much of incisions, just we have detached it from its original position and bringing it to a more apical or a more better position, which is not prohibiting the performance of other surgical procedures or our daily oral hygiene procedures. We are just relocating the frenum. So we are, because in phrenectomy we engaged the frenum by a hemostat and gave two incisions, one above the hemostat and one below the hemostat, one each, and created a rhomboid or diamond shaped opening or wound, which shows all the underlying attachments which were successively eliminated. This is how phrenectomy is performed, but in contrast to phrenectomy, in phrenotomy, this is the engaged point, that is the phrenal attachment in the papilla. We give just single incision and we just detach the frenum from its original position and shift it apically. So because the frenum is not eliminated, here the frenum was eliminated completely and that's why a large opening, but here the frenum is not eliminated. In phrenotomy, the frenum is not eliminated, the frenum is very well present there, it's just that we are shifting it to an apical position. So the wound opening will look like this. Clear? Again, the widest portion corresponding to the base of the vestibule and the upper triangle aspect corresponding to the labial mucosa and the lower aspect corresponding to the gingiva. Here, then again, we work on to the lower triangle, that is the periosteum is cored and the residual muscular fibers are eliminated. Why? This will create scarring of the tissue and prevent any reattachment. Reattachment of the muscles as well as the frenum. That is why this step is performed. And pertaining to the upper triangle, a single suture in near to the this widest portion will approximate the entire labial mucosa margins. Why? Because it is a comparatively tiny wound. It is going just not just because I have drawn it tiny, but in practical also that wound will be tiny enough, which will co-approximate by a single suture near to this widest portion corresponding to the base of the vestibule. A single suture to approximate the labial mucosa margins will finish the procedure. This is how phrenectomy and phrenotomy are performed. Now, once these procedures are completed, what we do is we cover the surgical site with a sterile tin foil. Now don't get confused with the sterile tin foil that we used during root coverage. Of course, the material is same, but the purpose are different. In root coverage, we used sterile tin foil to record the dimensions and the shape of the recipient site. But here we are going to use it to cover the surgical wound, protect the surgical wound. So once we place the sterile tin foil, and then place our periodontal dressing. This dressing should be removed after 2 weeks. Redressing can be done if the wound demands. Otherwise, not necessary. And usually 1 month and above to have complete healing and to see the new frenum, which is located at a new location in case of phrenotomy, and to see the new zone of attached gingiva or complete elimination of the frenum if it is phrenectomy. This is how phrenotomy and phrenectomy are performed. I hope these topics are clear to you all. These techniques are clear to you all. And if there are still any confusions, feel free to ask me in the comment section below or mail me at my email ID dentalstudiessimplified@gmail.com and I will do the needful. I hope the topic is getting easier for all of you. With this video, we have completed the first objective, problems with attached gingiva, and the second objective, problems with aberrant frenum. Now, in the next videos, we will discuss problems with shallow vestibule, aesthetics, that is black triangles management and gummy smile management, and tissue engineering. This is how we are going to complete this chapter, periodontal plastic and aesthetic surgery. And after that, we will take up all the requested topics and discuss them in detail thoroughly. Meanwhile, if you have any doubts or any queries, please ask me in the comment section below, mail it at my email ID or ask me on Facebook and Instagram and I will do the needful for sure. Thank you for watching and listening to me. Study well. Have a good day. Stay safe.